This is a fucking big room. It's awesome to see you guys. Thank you. Are a lot of you guys from Lisbon? How many people are from out of town? How many people are from Lisbon who are here right now? Like, wow, okay, almost everybody. Can I just tell you, I've been here for the last 4 days. This is one of the most beautiful cities I've ever seen in my life. And I'm not just saying that. It's really true. It's really true. I sound like a politician, like, no, it's really true what I say. Just believe me. It's true. It's great. I'm really glad to be here to talk to you about this thing that I've been working on. And I'll tell you a story about how it started. I'll start the story when I was 6 years old. That's when I started working as an actor in television and movies.
That's me.
And I always loved it. I really, really loved doing it. I was all grateful to get to do it. And I kept doing it throughout my childhood and adolescence. And then when I was 19, I quit acting because I wanted to go to college, which I did for about 20 minutes. And then when I wanted to get back into acting, I couldn't get a job. No one would give me a part. And it was really painful because I wanted to be creative, but I couldn't be. And at that point, I realized that I had to take responsibility for my own creative outlet. I couldn't just wait around for someone to give me a part. I had to be able to make things, express myself of my own volition. And I came up with this little turn of phrase to encapsulate this idea, and I'd sort of say it to myself sometimes for motivation. And that phrase was, hit record. Because I always had a thing for the, you know, the record button, the red circle that you see on video cameras. And it became this sort of symbol to me. Push that button to hit record meant to, like, to make something, to do it, to get started. And I did. I started making short films and writing stories and making songs. And then when I wanted to start sharing some of this stuff with the world, my brother helped me set up this tiny little website. And we called it hitrecord.org. Now, this is where it gets interesting. At that point, it was just this tiny little message board. But what we noticed was, even at that small scale, there were some people who wanted to just check out the stuff I had made. And then there were some people who wanted to just post about the stuff that they had made. But there were some people who wanted to make things together, both with me as well as with each other. And my brother and I thought, that's cool. That's like something that couldn't have been possible any other time in history before the internet. And this is what I want to talk about today, is communities coming together online to be creative together. And I don't just mean people sharing things online that they've made on their own. I mean people making things together that they couldn't have made without each other. So that was 9 years ago that my brother and I put up that little message board. And since then, the Hit Record community has grown quite a lot, and we've done some cool things, if I do say so myself. We've published books, we've put out records, we've screened our short films at film festivals, we've put on live events at big venues all over the place. We made a television show that won an Emmy. An Emmy is important in the United States. And thank you. That's why we were stoked to win the Emmy, because I was like, one day I'm going to be in Lisbon, and that'll be when they applaud when I mention the Emmy. And we did all these projects, and the thing I'm actually even more proud of than the Emmy is when those projects made money, we paid the contributing artists who worked on those projects, and that's also really important. So over the years, I feel like I've learned some things about what it takes for a community of people online to be creative together. So I thought today I would talk about, you know, some of the things I've learned. And here's the thing. I love the internet. I'm sure we all do. The internet has obviously been a very positive thing in so many ways. But I do think there are some things about today's online culture that limit our abilities to come together and be creative. And I want to bring up three of those things right now. I'm going to call these the three pillars of today's internet. And they are. They're coming. The crowd, free culture, and socializing. All right, so I'm going to dive into each of these and talk about them a little. Start out with the crowd. So we've all heard about the power of the crowd and crowdsourcing. I'm going to bring up two of the main ways that crowdsourcing happens nowadays. The first I would call big data-driven crowdsourcing. So this is where a huge number of people contribute their data without having to put any effort into it, oftentimes without even knowing that it's happening. And then a computer program is able to take all that data and do something useful with it. For example, like the app Waze, it amalgamates a bunch of user-generated data to provide traffic information. All right, so crowdsourcing like that, it can be really great, really useful for high-volume technical tasks. But it's not really good for anything creative. The second kind of crowdsourcing, it's common today, I'd call it an open contest, right? So this is when there's a task that needs to be accomplished, and anybody can attempt to accomplish that task, and then a winner is picked, and then that winner gets some kind of reward. One example of this is the company XPRIZE. I don't know if you know them, they're amazing. They've accomplished some terrific things, definitely creative things, like the creation of a reusable suborbital spaceship, or like innovative solutions to clean up oil spills. Really, really amazing things, and it's wonderful that they're getting them done. And they do this by offering big cash prizes to the winners of their competitions. Now, what this doesn't take advantage of is, obviously, you know, when one person has an idea, but they're competing with the other person, well, then this idea that this person had isn't very useful to this other person over here. In fact, this person's idea harms this person over here because it hurts their chances of winning the competition. Now, these competitions have been going on for a long time, really for ages. And it's cool that they're using the internet to run these competitions because it gives more people the opportunity to compete. But like I said, there's really some limitations on how these competitions can work because people are competing with each other instead of collaborating with each other. So this is sort of the limitation of what I would call an open contest, right? What it doesn't take advantage of is what would happen if all the different people that were competing were able to put their heads together in some kind of organized fashion. And my question is, would they be able to come up with something more than they could on their own? I think they could. So, okay, so that's the crowd. Next up, free culture. That's the second pillar of today's internet that I want to talk about. Now, it's a given that all of the world's culture and art and literature and science and journalism, et cetera, is available for free online, which is obviously awesome. And the biggest example of this is, of course, Google. Anything we want to know or see or hear, we just Google it, and there it is right away for free. But again, I do think there are some limits to this kind of free culture when it comes to our ability to be creative together online. And now I do acknowledge that, you know, the laws surrounding intellectual property and copyright in my country, they're antiquated and they probably need reform. In fact, this phrase that I'm using, free culture, it's the title of a book by a great legal thinker named Lawrence Lessig, and he's very critical of today's copyright laws, and I agree with him. However, I also firmly believe in the basic principle that if someone does some work and creates some kind of intellectual property, and that intellectual property is able to generate any kind of revenue, then that creator deserves some of that money. Right? It seems like common sense. Unfortunately, this is not often what's happening online in this context of free culture. There's another really good book I recommend if you're into this kind of stuff. It's called Who Owns the Future? It's written by Jaron Lanier. What Mr. Lanier says is, all that stuff that Google is serving you up for free, it's not really free. Because there is money being generated in that transaction. Because while the Google is serving you up the content, it's also serving you up advertisements. But none of that ad money goes to the creator of the content that's being served. All that money goes to Google. Now, This business model has already pretty much decimated the music industry. Granted, the music industry sort of had it coming in a lot of ways, but bottom line is it's a lot harder to make money, earn an honest living as a musician than it ever used to be. The same thing's happening in the field of journalism, especially more long-form, investigative journalism. As local and regional news organizations all over the world are having a harder and harder time staying in business, then highly skilled professional journalists, they're finding themselves out of a job. Mr. Lanier predicts that this damage won't just be limited to the music industry and the journalism industry. As more and more industries become more and more dependent on digital information, as they inevitably will, well, then those industries are going to be just as damaged by this notion that intellectual property is supposed to be free. Because if you spend your time and effort making something, but the only ones getting paid for your time and effort are a few giant tech companies, that's gonna disincentivize your creativity. So, that's what we call free culture. Next up, last of these three pillars of today's internet, I'm gonna call it socializing. And again, just like the other two, there are some huge upsides to what goes on via social networks or social media. People are able to connect with each other from all over the world and share their lives and their perspectives, and it can be really beautiful. Prime examples of this are, of course, you know, Facebook, Twitter, others like them. But as legitimate as the upsides are, I also think this kind of socializing online is limited in its ability to facilitate substantial and productive creativity. Because these platforms are not built for that. They're built for socializing. They're not conducive to elaborate or complex or nuanced processes or interactions. Like when you check your feed on Facebook, you never spend much time focusing on any one thing. You're just scrolling from the next thing to the next thing to the next thing. And by the way, that's how these companies make money. The more items you scroll through, the more ads you see. So it's in their interest to keep your attention span short. Facebook's landing page invites you to connect with your friends and the world around you. And again, I really do think that people connecting is a great thing. My question is, are there ways to take a step further, past just connecting and towards creating together? And of course, I think so. So, now I've talked about three of these pillars of today's internet. They're obviously not the only three, but they're three prominent things. And I'm just gonna reemphasize, I really do think all three of these things are truly positive in their own right. But, given their limitations that we were just talking about collaborative creativity, I wanna propose three alternatives to these pillars. And I'm not just making these up. These are sort of three principles that we've arrived at organically over the years of building and running Hit Record. Okay, so first, instead of thinking about the crowd, what if we think about community? Second, instead of thinking about free culture, what if we think about fair compensation? And third, instead of socializing, what if we think about collaborating? So I'm gonna talk about each of these a little bit, and then talk about how we apply them on Hit Record. All right, so first we have community as opposed to the crowd. To me, the biggest difference between a community and a crowd is that a community is made up of unique individuals. And so the strength of that community is less about the quantity of the people and more about the quality of their contributions and interactions. Like, I love how many people there are here, but all of you are unique people. And that's actually what's important. Each of you is individual. Now on Hit Record, sometimes we get called a crowdsourced production company. And I prefer to be called a community sourced production company. I know that's me being sort of nitpicky. But the thing is, I just feel sort of rude calling our community a crowd. It feels like I'd be failing to acknowledge all the unique individuals and their unique contributions that make our company what it is. And we can go back to, you know, the two different kinds of crowdsourcing that I was talking about earlier, and you'll see HitRecord doesn't really fit into either of these. There's the big data-driven kind of crowdsourcing, but at least for now, you know, there aren't any really number-crunching algorithms that can match human creative expression. Counting the number of likes can't replace a talented curator with good taste. So again, for now, and I, yeah. You guys, I'm genuinely fascinated to hear which of these things are the things that you respond to. So it's really cool to get to, I've been writing this for a while. It's cool to hear like, oh, that's an idea they really connect to. That's really cool, so thank you. What I was saying is, an AI is not gonna really be able to, you know, find the best stuff. You can't just count the likes. And I'm gonna say for now, right? Because I know there's probably AI fans out there. They're like, it's gonna happen one day. And that's cool. I look forward to, you know, the synthetic humanoid Mozart or whatever. I really do. I look forward to it. But for now, this kind of crowdsourcing, it can't really do what our community does. The other type of crowdsourcing that we talked about was the open contest. Now on HitRecord, we say it all the time. This is not a contest. We really try to emphasize that we're all working together towards a common goal. One of the most important ways we do this is with a methodology that we call remix. All right, so for those of you not familiar with the term, a remix is when you take something that someone else has done and you make it new. For example, say someone posted a simple drawing of a hamburger. Someone might download that drawing and, you know, turn it into an animation. That would be a remix. And everything that everyone posts on HitRecord is up for grabs to be remixed. So someone's personal story might be remixed into a script. And then other artists, like actors or illustrators or animators or musicians, they might build off of that script to produce a finished short film. And that might end up in our TV show. And this is how a bunch of smaller contributions from different people can all add up to a finished product. And you can see this process of people remixing each other, it's very different from a contest. In our community, if someone over here has a good idea, then this person over here can build on top of their idea, and maybe in ways that the first person never would have thought of, because everyone's working together. And when we finish something on HitRecord, like a short film or a song or whatever, it's not just a winning entry from a lone competitor. All of our finished work has been touched by many, many contributors, all remixing each other. We're all on the same team. We're part of one community. And that facilitates the kind of creativity that I've been talking about. And that kind of creativity, it would have been impossible before the era of the internet. So, yeah, thank you. That's community. And the HitRecord community is gonna be stoked that you just applauded for them. So thank you. So the next alternative to these three pillars of the internet, I'm calling fair compensation, and that's in contrast to free culture. So like I said earlier, and it bears repeating, if someone does some work, and that work generates some money, then that person deserves some of the money, right? On HitRecord, anytime one of our productions makes money, everyone whose contribution is featured in the final version of that production makes some of that money. Now, figuring out what's fair and which artists get how much money, that's no small feat, but we have an open collaborative process for that too. And we've been doing it this way for 6 years. We still haven't been sued, and we've paid more than $2 million to contributors in our community from all around the world. Hey. Now, there's a really great quote that often gets attributed to Walt Disney. And I like to say it when we talk about money on HitRecord. And that quote goes, we don't make movies to make money. We make money to make more movies. And that's the pervasive attitude within our community. People, they're happy to get paid, but I honestly think that for them, often it's not about the money, it's about the principle. They feel that their time and their effort has been fairly acknowledged and compensated, and I think that's a big part of what allows our community to be so productive together. So that's fair compensation. All right, lastly, as opposed to socializing, let's talk about collaborating. So what I mean by this is people connecting online, not just to socialize through bite-sized interactions, but to work together towards a common goal, to be productive, to be creative. On Hit Record, this is what we're all about, collaborations, people making things together. On our landing page, we say we're a new kind of online community working together as a production company. So one of the biggest ways that we achieve this is through the user experience, our web app, and our mobile app. When you come to Hit Record, you'll find that, you know, there are some things in common with most social media platforms, but you'll also find there's a lot of differences. And I'll give you a few examples. Anyone can issue what we call a creative challenge. So that could be a writing challenge or a photography challenge. And then writers and photographers can find those challenges and contribute to them. Then you can organize a series of challenges into what we call a project. And you can set deadlines, you can send out updates, and as you get contributions to the challenges that you're happy with, you can cross out the challenges that are done. You can see how close you are to your project being complete. And then we in the creative department at the Hit Record office, we maintain what we call our project development slate. So this is a front-facing list on the site of outstanding projects that we've decided to focus on as a production company. We categorize these projects into three columns. There's an earlier stage of development, then a more advanced stage of development, and then once a project has gotten to the point where we can, you know, secure some kind of distribution or whatever other kind of monetization, that's when we put the project into the funded column. Now, of course, that's the technology, but the technology alone, that won't get people to collaborate all by itself. Equally important is how we as a company use our technology. This whole model, it doesn't really work unless there's leadership. So the director of Hit Record is me. I'm the one with the final say on how our productions turn out, but I don't make these decisions alone, far from it. There's of course, our intrepid staff. And then we also tap quite a few individual members of the community who've proven themselves, you know, in their talent and their dedication. And between all of this, we're able to provide the guidance necessary to have our entire community working together as a cohesive whole. Now, do people make friends within our community? Yes. And do they care about each other? Yes, a lot. But it's not just because they've seen photos of each other's lunch orders from that day. It's because they're engaged in an intimate and creative process together. And the fact that they also consider each other friends, that just helps them collaborate all the better. So, community, fair compensation, collaboration. These are three principles that have become central to, you know, how we make things together on Hit Record. Things that no isolated individual could have made on their own. And that's the kind of creativity that I think the internet has the potential to facilitate. But when I say creativity, I don't only mean art. Of course, that's my area of expertise, that's what we do on Hit Record, but I'm really curious to see, and I'm sure there's some of you out there who are already doing this or are going to, I'm curious to see how these same kinds of principles might be applied to other fields, other industries. Like perhaps in the field of journalism. There's so many people out there who, you know, blog about the news independently. Sometimes it feels like a crowd shouting in an echo chamber. But what if they could form productive communities that collaborated on larger feats of substantial and investigative journalism? Then a lot of experts agree that our methods of education are in dire need of reinvention. So what if, rather than competing against your classmates because you're all graded on a curve, students worked on collaborative projects where they all pulled together as a team? And what if your team was not bound by the walls of your classroom? Thank you. That would have been awesome. A Especially if you could like collaborate with other people all over the world, not just the people in your classroom. It'd be great. And it would be what the future's gonna be like. Then we could talk about government. That's an area that's certainly been on my mind a lot these past couple days. And we did our best. Sorry. Now, obviously, the internet could and should be involved in modernizing the people's ability to be truly represented by our democracies. In fact, just a minute ago, former prime minister of Greece was talking about the same idea, and I was back there like, former prime minister of Greece talking about the same idea. Because what if we used like a similar process to how HitRecord makes art, and use something kind of like that to make policy collaboratively, and where everyone could be involved and contribute? However, I don't think that's gonna work unless our online culture grows up a bit. So that's something to think about. So the one thing I think you can say this for sure, is that as we move forward into the future, the internet will definitely impact every industry more and more. And the question is, what kind of impact is that going to be? But if people all around the world can come together and do more than just connect, if we can actually collaborate to make things together that we couldn't make on our own, when I think about that future, I start feeling optimistic. I start feeling optimistic about where we're headed. And it's not just because of the capabilities of technology, it's because of the capabilities that technology can give us as human beings. Thanks very much, everybody.